a pragmatic Afghan behind the religious garb. All eyes will be on the Taliban's character as and when they consolidate their power in a transformed Afghanistan. Personnel of the institutions responsible for monitoring India's external environment and ensuing the security of the country and its citizens probably know more about the composition and character of the Taliban than they are letting out. They would do us all a favor if they were to loosen up a little, since we need a vigorous national debate to reorient ourselves after the strategic situation was convulsed savagely over the past fortnight. Some pointers. The foremost question in the minds of those thinking about Afghanistan is whether there is a Taliban 2.0. Is this a dawah that stormed into Kabul on August 15 after capturing most of the country's 34 provinces in a whirlwind campaign, any different from the barbaric entity that ruled the Afghans between 1996 and 2001? Currently, the answer to that question is up in the air, since reports seem to support neither conclusion. We will perhaps truly know only if and when this dispensation consolidates its power. Meanwhile, we can consider some pointers. Between 1996 and 2001, when they were in power previously, the Taliban did almost nothing to improve conditions in what had by then become a devastated, impoverished country. All that the mullahs seemed to be interested in was oppressing women and minorities and providing sanctuary for jihadi terrorists from every part of the world. That crazed enterprise came to an end after the Arab guests overplayed their hand, massacred civilians in the United States on September 11, 2001, and invited retaliation that drove the Talibs back to their old sanctuaries in Pakistan. Their return to power has raised the strong possibility that Afghanistan will revert to primordial mode. Apart from the memory of the consequences of 9/11, are there other factors that could inhibit the Taliban from reverting to their old ways? The departure and after. No indication of a change in character of the movement or acceptability to the people is provided by the rapid disintegration of the previous government's defense apparatus. The melting away of an army raised, trained, equipped and paid by the US that was tasked with the mission of propping up the democratic order has occasioned much surprise. In retrospect, perhaps the only surprising element is that the event caused so much surprise. Amidst the current bewilderment at the ease with which the Taliban advanced, it is easy to forget that much the same pattern unfolded on the first occasion. The Taliban built up their presence and hence their strength steadily from pocket to pocket before moving towards a frenzied denouement. There seems to be a characteristic of Afghan warfare that combat is carried out for so long as it is feasible and given up as soon as it is not. A pragmatic Afghan behind the religious garb. Takti, Yas and planning for the next. With a rise in the frequency of devastating cyclones, India needs to look at long-term mitigation measures. Yashobhantha Paritha, Joy Teroy Chaudhary and Prakash Kumar Sahu. The severe cyclones, Takti and Yas, which battered India earlier this year, made landfalls on the country's western coast, Gujarat, and the eastern coast, Orisha, on May 17 and May 26, 2021, respectively. Both storms caused massive damage to infrastructure, the agricultural sector, and houses. Government of India reports are that, put together, an estimated 199 people died, 37 million people were affected, and economic losses stood at 320 billion rupees, $4.3 billion. In addition, crop area of 0.24 million hectares was affected, and around 0.45 million houses were damaged. Moreover, 2.5 million people were evacuated to cyclone shelters and relief camps in these two states. The large-scale uprooting of trees in the urban areas affected already depleting green cover. Thus, during the COVID-19 pandemic, these cyclones caused additional financial responsibility for state governments. The health costs need to be measured too. More frequent. Increasing sea surface temperatures in the northern Indian Ocean and the geoclimatic conditions in India have led to a rise in the frequency of devastating cyclones in the coastal states, accounting for 7% of the global tropical cyclones, according to India Meteorological Department, IMD, 2013 data. Every year, around 5 to 6 tropical cyclones are formed in the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea. Of these, 2 to 3 turn severe. The Indian coastline is around 7,500 kilometers. There are 96 coastal districts, which touch the coast or are close to it, with 262 million people exposed to cyclones and tsunamis. The World Bank and the United Nations, 2010, estimate that around 200 million city residents would be exposed to storms and earthquakes by 2050 in India. Between 1891 and 2020, out of the 313 cyclones crossing India's eastern and western coasts, 130 were classified as severe cyclonic storms. The West Coast experienced 31 cyclones, while 282 cyclones crossed the East Coast. The Odisha coast witnessed 97 cyclones, followed by Andhra Pradesh, 79, Tamil Nadu, 58, West Bengal, 48, Gujarat, 22, Maharashtra/Goa, 7, and Kerala, 2. The economic costs. Among the natural disasters, cyclones constituted the second most frequent phenomena that occurred in 15% of India's total natural disasters over 1999 to 2020. During the same period, 12,388 people were killed, and the damage was estimated at $32,615 million. Cyclones are the second most expensive in terms of the costs incurred and damage, accounting for 29% of the total disaster-related damages after floods, 62%. In addition, they are the third most lethal disaster in India after earthquakes, 42%, and floods, 33%. Staying invested. India must retain its traditional and historic interest in Afghanistan and its people. Prime Minister Narendra Modi's decision to ask the mayor to brief all parliamentary parties on the government's actions in Afghanistan comes as questions grow about the government's planning for contingencies there, with the Taliban's takeover. Since August 15, when the Taliban militia entered Kabul, the government, including the mayor and the defense ministry, has been understandably occupied with the challenging evacuation of Indian nationals. In addition, the government's decision to evacuate the entire embassy staff and security personnel first has made it more difficult to facilitate those Indians, as well as long-term visa-holding Afghan Sikhs and Hindus needing to return. With most of the Indians based in Afghanistan returning home, or expected to soon, the government must face the larger strategic questions over whether the Indian embassy was evacuated too early. India had undertaken evacuations during the 1990s too, but then the presence of Indian nationals was not as large and Indian stakes in Afghanistan were not so deeply rooted. In the past 20 years, India has built considerable interests, including major infrastructure projects and ongoing development projects, helped script the Afghan constitution and conduct of elections, as well as enabled the training and education of the next generation of officials, soldiers and professionals. It seems unfortunate, therefore, that this bank of goodwill came to naught as the government decided it was safer to pull up stakes, emulating neither the US and European countries who relocated their diplomatic outposts to the Kabul airport, nor Russia, China, and Iran, which decided not to vacate their embassies there. Going forward, the government must explain how it expects to approach the new regime in Afghanistan once it is formed. It is still unclear whether this will be merely a repeat of the brutal regime seen from 1996 to 2001, or whether negotiations are underway for a more inclusive coalition, including several former leaders of Afghanistan, will fructify into a transitional government. The rise of Taliban power and that of the group's Pakistani backers is a particular security concern as groups such as the LET and the JEM could use Afghanistan as a staging base for terror attacks in India. Finally, the government must explain how it will approach the Afghan people, especially those whose lives could be in danger, including embassy staff and associates, those working on Indian projects, minorities, including those Islamic sects such as the Hazaras who